Thanks, Jared. It's great to see you, buddy.
Hey, man, that was good. Poor Jared. That was quite something. Anyway, welcome here, everybody. Good to have you this morning. We actually do, as you heard on the video, we have Keith with us this morning. And so you probably saw his table set up out in the lobby. If you didn't, you were probably really focused on coffee or something else. But it's right there by the kids area. I want to encourage you after the service just to go there and have a conversation with Keith if you'd like to. Let's just have a quick word of prayer before we dive into God's word, shall we? Father, thank you for this morning. Lord, it's been a great morning being able to already just connect with you in worship and song and in communion, Lord, remembering what you've done for us. Lord, we ask now that, Lord, you would open up our hearts to your word, to the truth. Lord, may the word this morning not just be information, but may it rather be transformation, Lord. May it not be just facts and details and propositions, but rather, Lord, may it, in addition to those important things, be the very thing that stirs our hearts and brings about intense religious affections in us for you. For we ask this in Jesus' name. Amen. Well, it's been said that New Orleans started to sink a number of years ago, back in 1895, when at that time 5% of New Orleans was actually below sea level. And by 1935, nearly 30% of the city was below sea level. And today, more than half of the city is below sea level. And Hurricane Katrina, I think everything went under sea level, as we all know, in 2005. The city is truly a bowl surrounded by water, so much so that the city is, it's surrounded by flood levees, right, to protect the city from a catastrophic event, which, of course, that catastrophic event came in Hurricane Katrina. Now, I don't know about you. I've been to New Orleans. It was all right. It's a good place to visit. But I can tell you this. I wouldn't want to build a house in New Orleans. Now, if you did that, that's okay. That's your deal. I hope you got good insurance. You see, it's not the best place to build, is it? You know, when we lived in Utah for a number of years, the Salt Lake Valley, it's a similar kind of a situation. You have the valley, and then you have what's called South Mountain. It's not really a mountain. It's just a big, large hill. But up on the mountain, you get high enough, and you build up there, and you get a phenomenal view of the entire Salt Lake Valley. And especially when the inversion isn't in there, which is the time of the year like right now where all the sort of pollution sort of sits in the valley, and you've got the worst pollution almost in all of the United States, actually. But when it's not like that, it's absolutely beautiful. But here's the thing about building on South Mountain. You see, much like building in New Orleans, you're building below sea level. You're just asking for trouble. When you build on South Mountain, in many respects, you're asking for trouble, you see, because fires come through in the heat of the summer and they scorch those small brushes that are around in the area. And you know what happens as a result of that? The storms come in and the water washes it all out. And before you know it, houses are sliding down South Mountain. You see these massive homes, these beautiful homes that are just falling off the side of cliffs. And of course, then everybody begins to sue everybody because the person who did that didn't do the proper whatever foundation that's needed to be able to make sure that the retaining wall was not quite done and it should have been done better. And part of me wants to say, well, maybe you shouldn't build on South Mountain. Maybe you shouldn't build there. You know, Jesus had something to say about this kind of sorta in Matthew chapter 7, verse 24 to 27, didn't he? He said these words. He said, "Everyone then who hears these words of mine and does not do them will be like a wise man who built his house on the rock. And the rain fell and the floods came and the winds blew and beat on that house, but it did not fall because it had been founded on the rock. And everyone who hears these words of mine and does not do them will be like a foolish man who built his house on the sand, and the rain fell, and the floods came, and the winds blew and beat against that house, and it fell, and great was the fall of it. His point here is, Jesus is not giving us advice about home construction, is he? Although what he says about home construction here is actually true, isn't it? The people who live in New Orleans might want to take the advice and go, maybe we should just move a little out of the area. We can still enjoy this, but people on South Mount, maybe we shouldn't build there next time. Let's build somewhere else. But that's not Jesus' point here, is it? Jesus' point is this. He uses this example, illustration of home construction to say that we should give careful consideration to what we build our lives on. Jesus here tells us to build our lives on the rock of his word. And if we do that, if you do that, if I do that, then our lives will last through the storms that blow and beat against us. Jesus said these words at the very tail end of one of his greatest sermons that we have recorded in Scripture, the Sermon on the Mount, we call it, where he's just given his words over and over again on so many vital subjects about life. We have those words contained for us now in the Word of God, Matthew chapter 5 through 7. Jesus is making it crystal clear here. If you want to have this kind of a life, if you want to be a wise man or a wise woman, then build your house on the rock of God's Word. So in today's message, what I want to do is I want to take us on a little bit of a dive into a really long psalm, Psalm 119. It's a psalm with 176 verses. Oh, Lord, help us to put on our seatbelts, as this is going to be a long sermon. No. We won't be looking at all of the 176 verses. But it's in this psalm that we discover how David built his life on that foundation, the rock-solid foundation of the Word of God, and not on the sinking sands of the culture that's all around him. You see, the culture around us today, it's driven by the winds of relativism, isn't it? Driven by the winds of pragmatism. Relativism, the idea that simply says, you know what, your truth is your truth and my truth is my truth. You do you and I do me. But don't you tell me that what you do is something that I need to do and what I do is something that you need to do. Whatever you do, then do you. And pragmatism, the idea that, well, if it works, what could be wrong with it? Well, lots of things actually could be wrong with it. You see, when your life is anchored in the Word of God, rooted deeply in the Word of God, you are better able to withstand those winds of relativism and pragmatism. And David in Psalm 119 shows us how to do that. Now, before we begin, I want to invite you to turn in your Bibles, though, to Psalm 119. So if you have a Bible and you want to turn there, if not, I've tried in the outline that you have to give you the summation of what I've done in Psalm 119. But a few comments about Psalm 119 as we begin. Psalm 119 isn't just a random psalm of 176 verses. It's actually very carefully put together by David. It's a masterpiece, an absolute beautiful masterpiece, a masterpiece that you can see more clearly when you see it in the Hebrew text than you can when you see it in English. So it's 176 verses, as I mentioned, and it's divided. You may notice as you kind of look through your Bible at Psalm 119, and just take a careful kind of glance through page by page of that psalm, and you'll notice that it's broken into divisions. Most likely, your Bible will have headings for each of the divisions of Psalm 119. Mine, for example, begins with the word Aleph, and then the next word is Beth, and the next word is Gimel, and then Daleth, and then He, and so on and so forth. You see, what this is there's 22 sections in Psalm 119. The Hebrew alphabet actually has 23 letters in the alphabet, 23 consonants. The last letter, or two letters, look identical. So there's 23, but in many respects, it's 22, right? So the author of Psalm 119 built his entire psalm around the Hebrew alphabet. It goes even better than that. See, what he did in each section is eight verses. Deliberately eight verses. That's not our arbitrary breakup of division to sort of break up the book. It's the author's division where he wanted it to be. Eight verses, 22 sections, 176 verses. And here's the other part that gets even more fun. If you were to open up a Hebrew Bible, what you would see, because Hebrew reads right to left, not left to right, and in English it reads right to left, you would see in the right-hand column in verses 1 through 8, every single verse, all eight verses begin with the first letter of the Hebrew alphabet. Aleph, 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 all the way, all eight verses. The next eight verses in the next section, they begin with Beit, 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 Beit. The next section, eight verses, Gimel, 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 then Dalet, Dalet, Dalet. It goes all the way that way, all the way through 176 verses. You see, this is a masterpiece created for memory's sake. So that you and I, in a very sort of looking at this in a poetic way, looking at what he said, does with the Word of God, can say, this is incredible. We can actually remember this. It's not the only psalm that does that, but it's probably the most extensive of all the psalms that does this particular way of arranging the material. There's one other thing that it does, though. In each of those eight sections, the Word of God is described using various terms. So instead of just saying the Word of God, it uses words like this: the testimonies, laws, precepts, statutes, commandments, rules, way, or ways, and word. You see, the Bible is variously described, and each of those have nuances of meaning and understanding in terms of how we're talking about the Word of God. But I want to remind you of this one important truth, that this is not David sitting after the birth of Jesus and after the New Testament is written, because that would be really bizarre to think that way. This is David long before any of the New Testament was written and long before most of the Old Testament was written. Friends, that's astounding. What we're going to discover as we dive into Psalm 119 is we discover David, who has built his life on the Word of God, and what he says about the Word of God in Psalm 119 is so incredible in light of, in contrast to us today, how little of the Word he had. It's truly remarkable. So this morning, from David's depiction of the Word of God in this psalm, we're going to learn that David's view of the Word of God can really be an encouragement to us, how we think about the Word of God that we have. The fullness of God's Word, all 66 books of the Bible compiled together, inspired by God, inerrant, infallible, preserved by God for you and me. So if you're following along in your notes this morning, either in the hard copy received or digitally, maybe you're online kind of looking on the app and doing your notes that way, that's great too. But if you're following along, I want to just share with you two major points out of Psalm 119. Here it is. First of all, to have your life, to have my life, to have your life built on the rock of the Word, it all begins with delight. It all begins with delight. And so the first and foremost thing is this: delight yourself in the Word of God. That's what we learn from King David here. Delight yourself in the Word of God. Everything you see begins here, doesn't it? You know, we're talking about revitalization as a church. We're talking about relaunching and all of that. And I know from being in ministry long enough and a follower of Jesus for even longer, I know that at some point in our lives, it is possible to become kind of meh about the Christian life. Become kind of sort of dull and drab about the Christian life. That the Word of God somehow becomes kind of like, yeah. You see, I know that we can have access to something all the time, whenever we want it, and because we have access to it, whenever we want it, we don't have the same, sometimes, delight and desire for the thing that's in front of us that means so much. But take that thing away. Like when I was in Canada for 3 years and I couldn't get Chick-fil-A. Why? So driving to the United States, risking all COVID protocols, and I would go all the way down to Marysville in Washington, and I would go to that beloved Chick-fil-A. Ah, oh, I would satisfy my soul on Chick-fil-A, the Lord's chicken. We can't even compare the Word of God to that, I know. And then when you have it all the time, you still desire it. And that's what's awesome about it. I went 3 times this last week. This is confessional. So, Trina wasn't home. She was traveling. It's not her fault. It's mine. I was really busy after the message last week. I was like, Lord, I feel so hurried. Help me not to be hurried. I'm so busy this week. I need the Lord's chicken. So I went 3 times and I got it. 3 times. And I did it all through the app because I had so many points. I justified it going, oh, I've earned this. Yes. So everything you think about it in our Christian life begins there at the core of desire, doesn't it? We talked about this in message number 1 in this deeply rooted series, that it all begins with desiring God. If we don't desire God, or somehow, somewhere along the way, our desire has become kind of like, Lord, I want to. It's just not there. And these messages are reminding me that something that's missing in my life. That's a good thing. That's actually a wonderful thing. That's a grace from God. And everything begins with desire. And so David has this incredible delight in God's word. And he also has this incredible desire for God's word. And so if we look at what David states in Psalm 119, I provide it for you in just a list of a bunch of texts out of Psalm 119 where he expresses his desire and his delight in God's word. We're going to read through this list. And I'm doing this because I want you to capture his heart in here. That's the point of this. It's not to exhaust you with a list of scripture. It's for you and I to see, look at how he talks about the word of God. Is this my speech? God, is this my heart? Here he said, my soul is consumed with longing. I have sought out. He's all talking about the word of God. I've sought out. I delight in the law from your mouth. Is more precious to me than thousands of pieces of silver and gold. I love your commands more than gold, more than pure gold. What a statement. How sweet are your words to my taste, sweeter than honey to my mouth. I stand in awe of your laws. I open my mouth and pant, longing for your commands. Remember, this is spoken or written by an individual who didn't have very much by way of the word. And yet in that, what's been revealed, he desired it so intensely. He says, my heart trembles at your word. Oh God, would you give us a trembling? Your statutes are wonderful. A number of years ago, I came across somebody who had made a comparison between cell phones and the Bible. And they said, I wonder what would happen if we treated our Bible like we treated our cell phones. And they just asked some questions like, what if we carried it around in our purses or pockets? What if we turned back to get it if we forgot it? What if we flipped through it constantly throughout the day? What if we used it to receive messages from the text? What if we treated it like we couldn't live without it? What if we gave it to our kids as gifts? What if we used it as we traveled? And if we used it in case of emergency? And on you can go with this. Somebody might respond and say, well, but I got my Bible on my phone. So, okay, I'm going to go old school on y'all. Who like your Bible on your phone, thank God for technology. Nothing will replace the hard copy, friends. Nothing replaces the hard copy. To know the Word of God, to flip through the pages, to feel the pages, to mark the pages, have the pages mark your heart as you mark the pages. Like, now I know that's old school to some people, and I use my Bible on my phone periodically as well, but the Word of God in written form is precious to us. So precious in a hard copy. Robert Sommer wrote a book called The Wonders of the Word of God, and in that book he tells a story of a man from Kansas City. Oh, that just happens to be interesting to mention that today because there's a football game, by the way. But this man from Kansas City was severely injured in an explosion. His face was badly disfigured. He lost his eyesight as well as both of his hands. He was just a new Christian, and one of his greatest disappointments, he said, was that he could no longer read the Bible as a new believer. He heard about this lady, however, in England who read Braille with her lips. Hoping to do the same, he sent for some books of the Bible in Braille. Much to his dismay, however, he discovered that the nerve endings in his lips had been destroyed by the explosion. One day, as he brought one of the Braille pages to his lips, his tongue happened to touch a few of the raised characters in Braille. He could feel them. A flash of light, as he describes it, came to him. He thought to himself, I can read the Bible using my tongue. By the time Robert Sumner wrote this book called The Wonders of the Word of God, in that book he said that man has actually read through the entire Bible four times. Talk about a hunger and a desire for the Word of God. God, I don't have any hands to be able to turn the pages. God, I don't have any fingers to feel. God, I don't have the eyes. All I can do, God, is use my tongue. And he could read the Word of God. Now, why did David have this intense desire and delight for the Word of God? I think there's two reasons that come out. As I study Psalm 119, there's two reasons that emerge, right? So I read Psalm 119, and I kind of go through and I systematize it and organize it, I guess if you could say that, to sort of take the whole thing and kind of crunch it into a sermon, right? And here's what I discovered from David. Two reasons why he had such an intense desire and delight in the Word of God. Reason number one is this. He believed the Word of God is reliable. He believed it to be reliable. And he states this repeatedly through the psalm. Notice the list of things. All your commands, he said, are trustworthy. Your word, O Lord, is eternal. It stands firm in the heavens. Your laws endure to this day. To all perfection I see a limit, but your commands are boundless. Your laws are righteous. Your promises have been thoroughly tested. Your law is true. Your statutes are forever right. You establish them to last forever. The word of truth, the ordinance of the Lord are sure. Over and over again, David in this psalm expresses from beginning to end the reliability of the text. You see, here's the thing. If we question the reliability of the text, which I would say to you, if you question it, don't fake it. If you really question it, then you question it. Just be honest with that. Don't pretend to not question it. Embrace that and say, God, help me to understand better why your word is reliable. But you see, if we question the Bible's reliability, or if we question whether the Bible is trustworthy, until we settle that issue, we will struggle with delight. Right? It's really hard to delight in that which we do not trust, right? It's hard to delight in something that we find maybe not to be reliable or trustworthy, but you sort of come to the conclusion that the Word of God is reliable. And for some of you, I would suggest this. If you are there, then you may need to do something more than just say, I'm just going to will myself to believe it's reliable. Get facts. Get information. I just revisited an article that I had read quite a few years back now. It's from Biblical Archaeology Society, also known as BASS. And that article is called 53 People in the Bible Confirmed Archaeologically. You want to know the book is rooted and anchored in history, that it's not fiction? Read that article. But you see, it's a whole lot more than that amazing article. It's not just the names of 53 people from the Old Testament that are confirmed archaeologically, but there's also sort of the historical veracity of the text, the geographical depictions, places that you can go today. As I mentioned before, I was just over in Jordan. I've been over to Israel. I've been over to Turkey. I've seen the sites. I've seen the locations. Been there and witnessed it with my own eyes. There's the prophetic fulfillment of Scripture. There's the evidence of the text itself. There's so much evidence that exists there, so much that is compelling, that if you have a heart that's unsettled about the trustworthiness and the reliability, your heart and mind can often find a settledness in looking at the data. And then you sit back and you say, Lord, thank you for this information. It has brought such peace to my heart, knowing this. So that's the first reason I think he desired and delighted in the Word of God. He just knew it was reliable. The second thing is that as you read Psalm 119, he believed the Word of God is beneficial. I compiled all of his statements, at least I think I got all of his statements, where he talks about the benefits of the Word of God. They're sort of in this big list for you. By knowing the Word of God, for example, this is what David says, you'll be blessed. Be free of shame, be kept pure, be kept from sin, discover wonderful things, be made free of scorn, receive counsel, have your life preserved, be sustained, receive strength, have disgrace removed, find freedom, experience comfort, be kept from perishing, become wiser than your enemies, have more insight than the elders. Who doesn't want that? I always wanted that when I was a Bible college student. I was like, yes. Have a lamp to your feet and a light to your path. Find joy, find direction, gain understanding and wisdom if you're simple. Know great peace, be kept from stumbling and experience deliverance. And then there's so many other passages we could run to that talk about other benefits of Scripture outside of Psalm 119. But just look at a couple of things in Psalm 19 and Psalm 1. In addition to all of that, the Word of God warns us regarding sin, rewards us for keeping the commandments, revives our soul, makes us like a tree planted by the streams of water so that we are fruitful in every season. Friends, that means our root system goes down deep with the Word of God. We are deeply rooted. So when the storms of life comes, the difficulties of life comes, we are down deep. That's what it means to be deeply rooted. So to build our lives on the rock of the Word, David shows us, it begins with this desire for the Word, this delight in the Word, to do that like he did. How do you respond even at this point to this? You see, I think for me, when I go through these things on my own, I don't probably need a big, huge mountain of fancy application. The application often is right in front of me on something like this, and it's me asking myself questions like, Lord, am I like David? Like, do I really delight in your Word and desire like that? Do I look back in time at an earlier time in my spiritual life where I did, and it's not so much anymore? Have other things taken away from my time in the Word, replaced it now with a novel, a magazine? Not that any of those things in and of themselves are even wrong, right? They're not. But has the Word of God become something that's been put on a shelf, left in the back of my car? I remember they used to have back dashboard. You know, you'd often see people in church that you're like, is that your church Bible? Because I notice it's like always there. Do you ever take that inside your house? No, that's my church Bible. Okay. All right. You see, those are the questions that emerge for me as I study Psalm 119. They're questions that drive down into the heart of saying, Lord, are my desires like that for you and for your Word? So that's the first thing. The second thing that I want you to note is to have your life built on the rock of the Word. We need to devote ourselves to the Word. For you to devote yourself to the Word of God, for me to devote myself to the Word of God. Desiring and delighting it is one thing. And now we move from that to devotion to the Word. And what we discover in Psalm 119 is that David expressed this devotion in four ways. Four ways that I'll share with you. Number one, first of all, he expressed this devotion in prayer. He expressed his devotion to the Word in prayer. Notice what he says about prayer and its connectedness to the Word of God. He says, open my eyes that I may see wonderful things from your law. Teach me What a great simple prayer is that. I'm up in the morning, open my Bible. Teach me. I open my Bible, open my eyes, that I may see wonderful things, Lord. Next one, give me understanding, God. Strengthen me according to your word, Lord. Direct me in the path of your commands. Turn my heart towards your statutes. Give me discernment that I may understand your statutes. He's asking God for understanding of the word, understanding how to live out the word, to obey the word. You see, we can miss God in our Bible reading, can't we? Oh, the Bible can become a book to be studied. It's easy to happen. It was always a danger in Bible college and then in seminary and that you become a student of the book, rather more so than a student of the creator of the book, the author of the book. You study it, you know it. You know it inside out. You've got the Bible so well marked, but the Bible hasn't really marked you, right? Oh, that's a danger in our lives. You see, we always have to have ourselves return and say, God, help me to return to the simple, basic truth is that I read the Bible because I need you. I need your voice in my life. I need your word in my life. I need to connect with you, God. Why else would you pray? You pray because you need closeness with him. You need to deepen the walk with him. You read the word saying, Lord, I need you. Speak to me through your word. The second way that he expressed his devotion to the word is this. It was expressed in meditation. He meditated on the word. Notice what he says. I meditate on your precepts. Your servant will meditate on your decrees. I meditate on your statutes. Notice again the way he's describing the word of God variously. Oh, how I love your law. I meditate on it all day long. My eyes stay open through the watches of the night that I meditate on your promises. Incredible statements. David here is saying that he's telling us what he meditates on and when he meditates as well. He's saying he's meditating on the word of God, broadly speaking, the precepts, on your precepts, on your decrees, on your statutes, on your law. All day long I do this. At the watches of the night even, I meditate upon your word. You know, last week in the message, I think it was then, I mentioned the shepherds in Jordan that I encountered that seemed to have all the time in the world. They'd lay by the creek or the crick, I guess depending on where you live, and they would just have their sheep around them, and then they'd get up and move eventually. It's that kind of time that gives you the space for really meditating, isn't it? But meditation here needs to be properly understood, you see, because biblical meditation is not the emptying of one's mind. Meditation, biblically, is different than that. Meditation is also different than the studying of God's word. That, too, is really important. You know, Martin Luther, it was said of him that he studied the Bible in the same manner in which he gathered apples. First, he would shake the whole tree to let the ripest fruit fall. And what he meant by that was the studying of the entire Bible as a unit. And then he would climb the tree and shake each limb. What he meant by that was individual books of the Bible. And then he would move to the branch as each branch had a limb. And he referred to that as the chapter study in that book of the Bible. And next he would shake each twig, referring to the paragraphs and the sentences contained in the chapter. And then finally he would look under each leaf and study every word. You see, that was Luther. That's the studying of the word of God. That's different than meditation. The study is absolutely important, but it's not the same as meditation. So what exactly do we mean by meditation if it's not the emptying of the mind? What is it? If it's not study like Luther is talking about, then what exactly does it mean to meditate on the Word of God? A number of years ago, Richard Foster wrote his book, Celebration of Discipline, and in that book he made this comment. He said, "The meditation of Scripture centers on internalizing and personalizing the passage. The written word becomes a living word addressed to you. This is not a time for technical study or an analysis of the text or even the gathering of material to share with others. That plays a really important role. I do want you to hear me saying that. We don't just bypass the study of Scripture. But once we've studied Scripture, there really is this sort of meditation side of Scripture, isn't there?" He goes on to state that it's important to resist the temptation to pass over many passages superficially, or our rushing, he says, reflects our internal state, and our internal state is what needs to be transformed. Dietrich Bonhoeffer, he said, recommended spending a whole week on a single text. Therefore, my suggestion is that you take a single event or a parable or even a few verses or even a single word and allow it to take root in your life. You see, that's really encouraging thought to do. You see, that's meditation, right? It's not the emptying of the mind. It's actually the sort of the filling of the mind, which is a ruminating over the text over and over and over again, and letting that word spill over into your day, your days, your week. I remember as a youth pastor, I was a youth pastor in a church that had youth group that had been, you know, several generations of believers' families, third, fourth, fifth generation kids that were going to church. And, you know, we had way too much for them. Way too much intake of the word, if that sounds maybe a little odd. But you do know, you like, we can take in too much, right? And when we take in too much, we end up we don't know what to do with it, and we don't have the time to do with it. Better to sort of chew on a smaller amount and really ruminate and reflect over it and really apply it than just mass quantities and do nothing with it or little with it. When we had so many sort of feeding times for our high school ministry when I was a youth pastor, I remember sitting back thinking, man, I'm running myself ragged for one thing, and they're looking up at the ceiling on Sunday morning because they were up late doing whatever else on Saturday night, and I'd always be saying, guys, you're not going to find the answer up there. Look to your Bible. Put your head down. But you see, they had a Wednesday night. They had meetings that we would have at the school where we gathered the Christian kids together there. We would have Sunday morning church. We would have Sunday morning Sunday school. We would have Friday night type things that are events or whatever, like Wednesday midweek studies. Too much in some cases. I'm not at all endorsing the idea that we dumb down our amount of Bible intake for the sake. No, it's purposeful and intentionally saying what I'm actually doing with what I'm receiving. Does it actually internalize and make a hill of beans a difference in my life or not? Or am I just becoming fat in terms of information and out of shape because I'm not living in application and in this whole area of meditation? So David's devotion is expressed in prayer. His devotion is expressed in meditation. And thirdly, his devotion is expressed in meditation, or memorization, I should say. Psalm 119, verse 11, he has this statement, "I have hidden your word in my heart that I might not sin against you." The little bit of the word that he had, he says, I've hidden it in my heart. When I went to Bible college, I had a friend that became a friend in Bible college and discovered that this young guy, like I was a young guy at that time, and we were in Bible college at whatever, 18 or whatever years of age. He grew up on a farm in Canada, and what a godly guy this guy was. And already by the time he entered into Bible college, he had memorized already 8 books of the Bible, 8 New Testament books. I was blown away. And he continued on that track when he was in Bible college, just kept on memorizing, because he knew the importance of internalizing the text. My cousin and I started doing that a little bit too, never even attained anywhere close to what our friend did. You know, at Easter time, this Easter of 2024, we're going to be preaching through with all of Harvest. We'll all be going through the book of 1 Peter. 1 Peter has 105 verses in it. We have 71 days, counting today, until that first message. That's 1.4 something verses per day to memorize. I'm going to give you a challenge. And you don't have to take the challenge, because you may be doing something completely different. But here's the challenge. This may be too big of a goal, so let's adjust it. Can you imagine in preparing our hearts to hear the Word of God right after Easter? What if you memorized 1 Peter? Or maybe the whole book is too much, so you just simply say, you know what, to prepare myself for after Easter, that first Sunday after Easter, I'm going to memorize portions of 1 Peter. Maybe a chapter. You see, what's the whole point of doing that? It's to prepare the heart for the proclamation of the Word in advance. It's to internalize the Word. It's part of the memorization of Scripture so that you hide it in your heart, always keeping the why in front of you. Why do I do this? So that I can tell people that I memorized a book? No, you internalize it so that it can begin to transform you. And as you internalize it, you are also meditating upon it and reflecting. So that's my challenge. To perhaps say, you know what, I'm going to take the challenge. I'm going to try to memorize the whole book by April the 7th. I got 71 days. Or you might adjust that and say, you know what, I'm going to memorize half of the book. Or I'm going to memorize just like 3 or 4 verses out of each chapter. I want to encourage you to try memorization. David saw the importance and value of it. And then the fourth thing is that David, his devotion was expressed in daily habits. Daily habits. He said in Psalm 119, verse 147, he said, I rise before dawn, I cry for help, I have put my hope in your word. That was his practice. The start of the day, he met with the Lord. In Psalm 5, the psalmist says, give ear to my words, O Lord, consider my sighing, listen to my cry for help, my King and my God, for to you I pray. In the morning, O Lord, you will hear my voice. In the morning, I lay my request before you. And don't believe you're going to do anything with what I asked. Well, he doesn't say that, does he? He says, I lay my request before you and wait in expectation. You know, we've always told people through the years, pastors, you have, perhaps I have, you know, it doesn't matter when you meet with the Lord. I mean, the Bible doesn't mandate a time. It doesn't say thou shalt meet with the Lord at 4:35 a.m. every day. Most of us might be in trouble because that's a tough, tall order at 5:35. Thank God that the Bible doesn't mandate a time. But I will say this. It's really interesting to me, sort of almost across the board, when you look at like some of the great men and women of God in history, the most godly people, it's really interesting to me that they had a pattern in their lives of early morning rising. That before everything else unfolded in their day, they went to him first. Now we can do this anytime, there's no doubt about it. But we also see David understood that. You see, there's a certain value about doing that, isn't it? It's the value of saying, before anything happens, Lord, I'm handing it all over to you at the beginning of the day. And Lord, before anything happens, I need to hear your voice in the text. And give me something I can walk away from here into my day that I can hold on to through the day. One of the hardest parts of early morning and reading the Word and doing these things is walking away and forgetting what we read. Isn't it? just like we'll walk away from the sermon and potentially forget what was said. Why is that? Because our lives are full. Our lives are full. It's not that we're trying to forget. It's just our lives are full. But with a little more intentionality in our lives, we can actually do some things differently as God's people, can't we? David in Psalm 119 also said, "At midnight I rise to you to give you thanks for your righteous laws." Now, where does all of this lead us? Well, we've seen in Psalm 119 that David delighted in and desired the word because he knew it was from God and therefore reliable and beneficial for all of life. For these reasons, we read in Psalm 119 of his devotion to the word of God, a devotion that's expressed in praying for God to teach the word, a devotion to meditating on the word, a devotion to memorizing the word, a devotion to studying the word every day, every morning, so that he would know the Lord more deeply and have his life built on the rock. That's it. So, my friends, the question for you then today is, what foundation are you building your life on? Is it the rock-solid foundation of the Word of God? Or is it on South Mountain or down in good old New Orleans? I want to encourage you to think about what you currently do with the Word and with the Lord and say, "Lord, are there areas in my life I just need to make some adjustments?" You know, the Lord loves you. He's never angry with us because we've left this on the back of the car. He just desires. He desires us. And he wants us to desire him. And it's when we desire him and we take great delight in him that everything else makes sense. Let's pray together. Lord, we give you thanks for your word. Lord, I'm so humbled by this text in so many ways because I think of the little that David had in contrast to what I have, and I think to myself, Lord, there should be so much more that I could say personally about your word. And I find my heart truly challenged and encouraged by David. And God, I thank you for that. Because you're at work in my life and you're at work in my brothers and sisters' lives here. Lord, you want to take us deeper with you. You want to restore us or revitalize us, Lord, or renew us or whatever other R word we can come up with, Lord. You want to do a fresh work in us. And so, Lord, as we leave from here and go into the week, Lord, would you help us to, Lord, that you would grab a hold of us, Lord, with regard to your word, that we would not forget, God, what you have spoken to us about this morning, and that, Lord, this might lead to us being even more deeply rooted than we currently are today. We thank you for this in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen.